you heard there, it's a bit of a celebrity fest today on the programme. Not something we normally indulge in. And we'll continue in that vein because we have with us the brand new presenter of Nationwide on RT1, Anne Casson. Anne, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon, Sean. I'm glad to be here.
I'm very glad.
I'm really dumbstruck there for a second.
You were dumbstruck there. You didn't know what to say. So people should know Anne and I go way back since dinosaurs roamed the earth there were phone boxes and telephones and typewriters.
I think we shared houses and so forth.
We did share houses.
But I have to say, Sean, you dress much better now than you did then. I noticed your shoes are very classy. Let me tell you. This guy used to go around in duffel coats.
I never had a duffel coat. Certainly did.
I think so.
In which house did I have a
College of Commerce Rath Mines, maybe? Or was
in the College of Commerce Rath Mines, yes, I was rather unkempt.
I am right, yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
you were right. Yeah,
none of us dressed well in those days anyway.
Well, you always did.
Oh, thank you very much.
You were about the only one, really. Seeing that we started there, what did you want to be when you grew up, so to speak?
I had a notion in my head about two things. I wanted to be a film editor, or if I couldn't get to be a film editor, I wanted to either be on the radio or on the telly. I had a notion that it was better to be in front of the camera rather than behind it. And after that, it was fairly vague as to how I would get there. But I was not really into the production side of the broadcasting side of things. And I pretty much, in terms of the large ambitions, kind of I'm doing what I wanted to do.
I remember the Gaiety School of Acting. This is great. I know the answers to all your questions. The Gaiety School of Acting, because that's in the blood. Your dad, many people will know Barry Casson. There was a bit of that.
That's very true. And have to say, Dad is working. He was filming yesterday on the Neil Jordan film Byzantine out in Ballymun with Saoirse Ronan. I was there watching them.
Great.
He's done 3 days, and it's really. I'm just so proud of him. It's a great achievement for him to be doing that at his advanced years. And I did do a year with the Oscar School of Acting. I discovered in the course of that year that I didn't really have what it takes. And I think you have to need to want to actually need to act. And I didn't have, I was too wound up, too buttoned up, I think, as a personality in myself at that age. And I abandoned it after a year. And I think the show-offy side of me finds expression in a bit of telly.
A bit of telly.
But I didn't make a wrong choice to leave acting.
Yeah.
But you have an elephantine memory, Sean.
Well, that's about it now.
It's going to be a bit dodgy now.
That's it now. That's all I recall. Like, I remember there's a huge gap of about 30 years then between that. And the other thing I do remember that in those days, if you wanted to get on air at all, that it was fairly tough. There was only RTE and a raft of illegal radio stations.
And you, with
no conscience whatsoever, you wantonly broke the law on numerous occasions.
Yeah, I worked for the famous Radio Nova, Pirate Radio we called it in those days, for Chris Carey, along with people like Brian Dobson and Sybil Fennell and Shane McGowan and but those were the only places where you could get practical experience on the radio. I mean, the opportunities for people now are manifold, really. There is a local radio in every decent big town around the country, and there are so many other opportunities, and they are legal, which is a useful thing, because when you're young, I suppose, you take your chance where you get it. And I did, I suppose, about 5 years in total up on Pirate Radio and Radio Nova, and then subsequently on a radio station called Q102, reading the news. Plagiarising it from RTE, I have to say, in those days, and then rewriting and putting it out. Anyway, we got over that.
And when you were in Nova and when you were in Q, and this is not to confuse people, the current Q102, this was a pirate Q102.
Absolutely.
Were the guards ever knocking at the door? Was there ever a sense that you might be closed down at any moment?
Yeah, it happened certainly once or twice in Radio Nova. We had closed down, and what occurred was the radio signals were jammed, and so the radio station would be broadcasting, and this loud whistle, wheeze, noise destroyed the signal, and that's how we were closed down. But I do remember, I remember Brian Dobson was there on the day that the guards actually entered the building, and they formally, you know, took us off the air, gave us a countdown, so that we told the listeners, and of course, the radio station used the opportunity to drum up a bit of drama. Mm. So by the time the close down came at 6 o'clock, let's say on the Friday or Saturday evening, now my grasp of the details of it are not exactly precise, but we counted it down, and then the DJ asked the population of Dublin to sound their horns or whatever.
That's right, yes, and that got a massive response.
It did, yeah, and it was in Herbert Street in Dublin too. I think an anorak like David Harvey or somebody might actually have some video footage of it somewhere, but that is as clear as anything in my memory. We closed down, the law was respected. I went home to Balbriggan because I had just lost my job, and I was phoned on the Monday to say the radio station had opened up again and to work. That's true.
And did that happen more than once?
I think it did, Sean, but that's my clearest memory of it. Yeah,
and Chris Carey was one hears various depictions of him.
Yeah, well, he was a buccaneering, entrepreneurial type. He has since died, and he had a history as a DJ himself on the boats of the famous Radio Caroline, you know, the pirate radio stations. That's where the word derives from. Who were broadcasting from the North Sea or the English Channel or wherever it was, I can't remember. And he was the instigator, and he was the person who funded the setting up of the pirate radio station. I mean, I can look back at it now with a mixture of nostalgia and, you know, telling the story sense. But I mean, it was law-breaking at the time, you know. And I think what really, when it began to steal advertising revenue from the legitimate radio stations, namely RTE, I think really that's when the politicians took note and they took some action.
Mm. They, somebody wants to know how will pirate radio stations pay their staff? Did they have advertisers? Well, obviously, you just answered that question. Yeah. And they did attract a lot of advertising. They did.
They did deals all over the place. What was kind of revolutionary at the time, not revolutionary, okay, I'm maybe talking it up, was that I had never experienced clutter-free radio. Now, it's completely old hat now. You play three songs in a row and the DJ doesn't announce them. You just play. So it was, his selling point was clutter-free, minimal talk, headlines at the top of the hour, and advertising. So, you know, you got to, and the signal was absolutely crystal clear, so people could get it. So I think it was 88 FM, was it? 88.5. I can't remember. I have stickers at home, old-fashioned stickers. So the product, the radio product that people were getting was young and fresh and youthful. Imported from the US, of course, but this was our first experience of it.
It was format radio. It was the first time in Ireland for format radio. And I suppose, because there was a lot of pirates around at the time, of varying qualities. Maybe Sunshine was okay, but Nova really kind of set the standard much higher.
And it had a professional, slick, gloss veneer to it that made people who were actually interested in radio want to work there.
Yeah.
And to learn,
Well, obviously it was run professionally. Were people paid poorly? Were they paid reasonably okay?
I think the DJs, the bigger names, were paid. I can't remember what I was paid. Was I paid? Could I have been paid? I couldn't have been paid.
Oh, you must have been paid. You were there for 5 years.
I think I was paid €80, or no, it would have been pounds. Would that be right? I mean, it sounds like quite a lot. And at the time, I think I was trying to get rent out of it and whatever else.
So I remember tapping you up for a few bob on several occasions, so it can't have been that bad.
I remember.
I have to pay the money back now, so we'll have to take a commercial right back in a second. Nationwide's new presenter Anne Casson is still with us. Carl texted, and many other people did as well. Can I just say, Anne is one of the finest looking women on RTE television. Very sexy, says Carl. Do you get that a lot?
No, but it's lovely to hear
liar.
It from time
you do.
To time. It's really nice to hear it from time to time.
Does it turn your head?
Stop that. I'll just go off Sean on grief.
But you must get recognised a bit by men.
A bit, but mainly by women or young children. And I was at the RDS on Wednesday, and so a lot of young children, not young children, secondary school students, of course, you see, they're not inhibited and they don't mind saying, oh, Anne, you're off the telly, and would you take a picture? But and it's older women as well.
And why are those two groups, do you think?
I think because older women have the confidence to say something like, I really like your hair, or where did you get that jacket? They're actually, they're intensely interested in what you wear.
Yeah.
Intensely interested. And that's great too. But I don't think men...
Won't ask you, where did you get your hair done?
No, I don't think they do that. That wouldn't be very manly, would it?
No, that wouldn't be very... And had you ever find that sometimes, that have you sensed any of these women maybe giving you a, you know, a quick once-over and perhaps disapproving?
Yeah, a bit. But normally it's they're you're being kind of sized up, I suppose, and it's usually it goes like you look much younger than you are. Thank you. Keep going. Or you're smaller or slimmer. There's usually one of those kind of things. And where do you get your clothes?
Right. Where do you get your clothes? Because somebody will text in and ask, don't you know, now that you've
said it. Well, there is a great costume department in RTE that helps me source stuff from time to time. And
but you buy your own clothes.
I would do, yeah. I'll be wearing this soon. Anyway, I buy a fair amount of clothes for the telly because it's 80% visual, Sean. You know what I mean? There's an awful lot of stuff that people take in, which is just the visuals of it.
But if you're a woman, is there more? There is more of a pressure there.
Yeah, but if we're going to go down the road of, you know, pressure to look young and all of that kind of stuff, I don't really know. The thing is that I have discovered over the years that how you present yourself is kind of, it cannot be ignored. And I put an awful lot of effort into making myself look kind of reasonably tidy and presentable, you know.
But it's still an unfair in the sense that people, no one's going to ask Brian Dobson, where'd you get your hair done?
No, they don't. They don't seem to register. It just seems to be part of our the way we're hardwired, that you don't seem to, doesn't seem to register what people wear. I know I'm kind of rambling a bit in the answer here because I watch television presenters or weather presenters or all kinds of people on the telly, and I size up straight away what they're wearing and how they present themselves to the world. And it's not necessarily the clothes they wear, it's how you choose to present yourself to the world. I think you impart a lot about yourself. So the suit imparts that you're kind of going to be a newsreader or whatever you're, and don't look at what I wear, listen to what I say. You know, I think wearing what you wear for the news is different from what you might wear when you're presenting a nature program.
That's true. That's
you know, true. And it's part of the package. But men do not come under the same scrutiny. But I say that as a matter of fact rather than a whinge. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Was Radio Nova's 50,000 phone-in competition the first competition that brought down the phone lines? I think you were saying, Andrew, in the ad break, that was kind of after your time. Do you, your guests, remember Radio Nova once a year would play Jeff Wayne's War of the Worlds? It used to freak me out as a wee fella, says Gordon the Van Man.
Sorry, Gordon.
Don't remember that either, but I think it was kind of probably one of their popular tunes. Anya says, is Anne one of those newsreaders who read whatever is put on the teleprompter? Is she a wrong burgundy, or is anyone that bad on RTE? Come on, dish the gosh. Dish the goss, says Anya. You look at the telly, you look at
I'm
the autocue before.
I'm going to answer that question completely truthfully.
Okay.
I would read and be fairly familiar with all the material before we go to air. Right, you're in a studio and you have a computer and you've spent the afternoon looking over the stories. So you're pretty familiar with the material and the stories you're going to cover. However, sometimes there's such a thing as breaking news and you really, really, really have to trust the program editor that what they're putting into the auto cue is correct. But the thing is, you're on open talkback the whole time. So they'll say something like, breaking news in Australia, there's been an earthquake, and you might have to busk a couple of sentences. But I think it's quite a skill to read what's in the auto cue unseen, but you have to trust that the person who's written it
has written it down correctly. Yes.
Yeah.
Sometimes that doesn't
always... It's breaking news sometimes, you know.
Sometimes that doesn't always happen, though. You have to go, hang on, change tense here. Very, very, very alarming. Now, as I have said, you're the brand new presenter of Nationwide, so it's you and Mary Kennedy. It's a fairly, you know, it's... How long has Nationwide been on the air for? It's forever.
Well, I know that Michael Ryan, who I have taken over from, was 18 years anchoring it. And in some shape or form, RTE has always had a sort of a countrywide, nationwide program. So it is a big brand in terms of RTE. Everybody knows it. It's very well loved. The figures are very good. I think it's something like 350,000 is the average share. But these that can fluctuate. And it's very well loved. I mean, I've discovered that. I mean, I knew it anyway, but I mean, it's come home to me more acutely in the last couple of weeks.
And in terms of your schedule, what will that mean for you now?
I think a bit on the road. I mean, I presented Capital D for 5 years. Is it 6 years? 5 years? 6 years? And we were very much the Dublin cousin of Nationwide, and it was a lot of feature based programs around Dublin. But this is going to be around the country.
Yeah, and but would it be a fairly heavy schedule for you? Is it going to does it eat into you? Lots of nights away and that kind of stuff.
Not sure yet. We'll see how it plays out. I'm not being evasive. We'll see how it plays out. But I think there will be days when it'll be go to Donegal and do links, and like in Galway the next day, Anne. Okay.
Yeah.
Do it.
That's kind of tough.
Oh, well.
Do you prefer that? Do you prefer doing EFP, as they call it, or in the studio?
No, that is just... I love both. And when I am in the studio and I'm, on a roster or doing a read, I'm there loving the live bit. And then I'm saying to myself, oh, great to get out and about a bit. And then you're standing in windswept Glendalough and your hair is being tossed and the hairspray is not winning the battle and you're cold and you've forgotten to wear your thermals and your high heels are sticking in the muck and you're saying, I'd love to be back in the studio again.
Yeah, that's
so,
the
I mean,
thing,
that's the human condition. We're never completely satisfied.
And you have to learn off lines as well when you're outside.
Yes.
That's a pain. I hate that.
Do you don't like it though?
Well, no, but just, when you've been in that situation like that, when it's minus something, and you have to look jaunty, and there's some words you keep stumbling over, and the more you do it, the more you stumble over it.
Yeah, would you not find, if you've written the stuff yourself, that it comes easier to you?
No. Because I've no recall whatsoever of what I said in the... So do you think you'll be on, like, Nationwide forever now? Because it's a kind of a... People tend to stay on that programme a long time.
That's a fair point. I hadn't thought about it like that. I really hadn't, honestly. I see it for the immediate and medium future, and let's just keep plans like that at the moment, really.
Is there anything that you'd like to do that you haven't done yet?
In terms of broadcasting?
Yeah. Oh, no, in terms of anything. Would you like to kill a man with your bare hands?
Do you know what I'd like to do, Sean? What? I'd like to complete the Art and Eat Challenge, which I'm doing tonight. I'm a little bit nervous and preoccupied about it.
What's that?
And that's off the subject of broadcasting, but it's a 54-kilometre walk, which starts at Dublin Castle tonight at midnight. And we're following the escape route of Art O'Neill, who escaped from Dublin Castle on the 6th of January, 1592. With Red Hugh O'Donnell and his brother Henry O'Neill. And he was incarcerated in Dublin Castle because he was a rebel. And he broke free and went through the streets of Dublin with his brother. And they made their way into the Dublin Mountains and then down to the Wicklow Mountains to escape, obviously, imprisonment. And this is the story, his route. And was very weakened by being in prison for such a long time, and he was only wearing his prison clothes and his shirt that he collapsed, I presume to some sort of hypothermia. They sent a servant on to Glenmalure to get help, and by the time help came back, he had died. Anyway, this is a challenge. Now, we are in the world of extreme challenges where people hop, run up mountains and, do Iron Men and all of that kind of palaver, but by hook or by crook, I am going to complete this walk. I'm doing it with my husband, Donna, tonight, and a few friends, but I'm actually quite nervous about it.
And are you just doing it for the crack, or you're doing it for...
I'm doing it with the challenge and kind of the crack, but I've seen the list of stuff we have to get, like field bandages and, three sets of clothes and fleeces and hats, and you leave one bag with in one of the camps, and then you walk from one to the first camp, and then if you've got to change clothes, you got to have a change of clothes. And just before I came here today, I went to the Great Outdoors to get such a thing as a field bandage, and they didn't have it, so I've got to go to camp to a chemist afterwards. So there you go.
And where will you end up?
In Glenmalure.
In Glenmalure.
About this time tomorrow, having walked all night, probably eyes swivelling in the back of my head.
Oh my God. So you'll have
so I would like to complete. That's
and,
what I
and walk 54 kilometres.
Yeah, yeah. So I'd like, that's what I'm really, that's really what's on my mind.
Have any of the people that you're going with, has Donna or any other people done this before?
Donna hasn't, but he's very, very fit. And some of our kind of loose group have done it before. And I'm slightly worried because I'm the girl and they're all boys.
Yeah, but you're fit.
Fit enough, yeah, and I'd be fairly determined, but at the same time, it's it was pretty cold this morning.
Yeah, and is it mostly, it would be uphill.
Yeah, I'm not worried about the elevation, but you walk from Dublin Castle through Temple Oak, I think out to sort of Bohorna Breena area. I'm not sure exactly where you join the mountains, and then it's a lot of it is track. Anyway.
Right, okay, so if at some point tonight you're coming home from the pub and you see Anne Casson hobbling through Temple Oak or any area like that, please give her a bit of encouragement because she's going for the big one. And lovely to have you, and best of luck on Nationwide. Big day.